everybody. How are we doing today? I hope you're all safe out there. Today I'm going to do a dozen John Coltrane records that I love. I've done a more extensive series on Coltrane where I covered his entire discography, including a lot of the side work. But this is going to have a closer look at 12 records I like. We're going to do some needle dropping here, some stuff. Coltrane, of course, has a prolific career. And he records 50, 60, 70 records in a dozen years. Of course, some of that's live stuff. But nevertheless, he's just one of the most prolific recording artists in jazz, and one of the most important as well. I'm shouting out to Toronto today, my hometown. I spent the first decade of my life there. I spent the next decade of my life near Winnipeg. I'm going to wear that jersey in my next episode. Just got to shout out to your hometown sometimes. Hope everybody's doing well, first of all. You know, that's super important here. I'm enjoying making these videos during this time. People seem to be appreciating having something to pay attention to that doesn't have all this fear and negativity in it. One thing I am pretty sure of, things aren't as bad as the TV would have you make you think. With everything the TV reports, they choose the sensational nuggets, they choose the negative news, whether it's on race, whether it's on politics, whether it's on the weather. The storm coming is going to be the worst storm you've ever seen. We're going to get feet of snow and weather alerts, beep, 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 warning, warning. I think there's a certain amount of fear factor going on right now that's adding to the hysteria, adding to the paranoia and the panic. It doesn't help, and we all get moments of anxiety in this time, but I think empathy and patience need to come to the fore, and it's tough. I got two teenage boys home from school right now, and I can't be patient with them all day long, I'll tell you that right now. But anyway, on to John Coltrane. An amazingly long career in terms of volume of content. His life was cut short, obviously, in 67. And we lost one of the great leaders of this music. But Coltrane does innovate in numerous stages of his career, and he never stays stationary long enough to stagnate. I think he's probably more innovative than Miles is, and Miles often gets a lot of credit for being such an innovator, but there's an awful lot of players who imitated Coltrane through various stages of his career. People were trying to mimic his sheets of sound. People were trying to mimic his playing during the spiritual stuff and the free stuff and the avant-garde. When Coltrane honked, he was fighting a demon. When everybody else honked, they were trying to be Coltrane. You know, that's kind of how my ears have always heard that. Anyway, he's a sideman for Miles, and he's around for a long time. And he's given his first solo work here in 57 on the Prestige label, where he'll end up having about a dozen releases. But if you listen to this, this is very traditional, straightforward, standard jazz. His name and star hasn't ascended yet in most aspects. They've gone to Columbia, the Miles Quintet, and they're starting to get some broader recognition. But Coltrane's still a fairly unproven talent, and he's still very much on the path to where he's going. I don't think there's any player in jazz, there is, I don't think there's any player in jazz who has a more distinct train track that he's not going to deviate from too far. Contracts be damned, producers be damned, sidemen be damned, this is the seeking destiny of my path that I must follow. And there's such a sincerity to it that you'll actually make allowances sometimes for some of the places he goes. But anyway, in this point of his career, he's still very much playing in the tradition of the Prestige kind of blowing session, blue note hard bop. Some great players are on this record. Being as it's his first solo venture, it's worth having for that in the cover alone. Paul Chambers, Red Garland, Al Heath. It looks like it changes up a little bit here. Johnny Splon, is on trumpet. I got Mal Waldron's on piano on a track here. So it's called from a few different sessions, which for Prestige was a very common thing. They were not super into the cohesive produce a record, have it have a cohesive feel or a produced direction. It was just tracks. But it's interesting because I think in that setting, it's easiest to decipher a player's personality. When you get into a session that's highly produced, highly arranged, those arrangements and productions are going to in some way dictate how, what a player plays, how he plays, what tempo he plays at. And in the setting that Prestige had here, it was who showed up at the studio today. These guys want their cash payout so they can go get fucked up. Let's put these guys in the room together and see what happens. Roll tape. And if we find a few tracks we like, we'll keep them and we'll delete the rest and record them again tomorrow. So Prestige in the early 7000 series, 7100 series, it's a lot of very loose stuff, but it has its own rewards because it's loose. A player can really kind of express his own personality and express his own directions and explore where he wants to go. Train's kind of endless in his ideologies. He can just keep playing and go until someone says, dude, slow down, take a break. Let someone else have the stage for a second. He ends up making a lot of records on Prestige. And a lot of them are sessions that were initially, like I said, kind of jam sessions, or they were under somebody else's name. There's only, like, I think, three actual records that were put out as Coltrane records, and even this one's for multiple sessions. So I picked the second Prestige. If you like any of these Prestige records, you'll like pretty much all of them. They all feel the same kind of sound. They're all from 57, 58. They're pretty much all hard bop with a blues and a ballad thrown in. The version of Lush Life on here is wonderful, and it's nice to have that instrumental version to compare to the version he does with Johnny Hartman 5 years later, which I think is angelic. But it's also beautiful here. You can hear the gorgeous beauty of the melody of this song. Billy Strayhorn composed it, of course, Ellington's sidekick. Coltrane, when he's playing a ballad, is capable of playing as lyrically and as beautiful as anybody. The song alone is worth making this a purchase if you come across it. Old Prestiges go for a lot. I recommend you get OJCs. They're often in mono and they often sound great for a fraction of the price. I love Prestige Coltrane for the reasons I've stated. It's not like the later stuff where there's a ton of insight into what the record's telling you. These records are more insight into who the player is and what he's, where he's coming from. Sadly, John Coltrane only does one record for the Blue Note label as a leader. He shows up as sideman on a number of records. But of course, Blue Train is one of the hallmark records in the Blue Note discography. I'd be willing to guess that this is the first Blue Note half Blue Note collectors come across. You start with Miles, then you get to Coltrane, and then you hear about Blue Note. And then you look at the Blue Note catalog and go, oh, I've heard about Blue Note. This is a great label. And you look at all the other names, and you're like, I don't know any of these guys. You know, I mean, that was my experience. I got this record, and I expected it to be all the other names I knew. But there was no Coleman Hawkins. There was no Miles Davis records. Well, there was a couple early ones, I guess. The Monk stuff's real early. Like, a lot of the names that people kind of know early on as a jazz fan, you're going to look at the Blue Note discography like, this is... It is fairly anonymous to a beginner. But this is what starts you down the path, and you start getting the Curtis Fullers, and then you hear about the Hank Mobleys, and the Lee Morgans, and the Sonny Clarks, and they all kind of play on each other's records, and before you know it, you're 50 Blue Notes deep, and you want to know how many more are there. And if you get 400, you'll have most of the important Blue Notes from the 12-inch LP era before the sale to Liberty. I love this record, and this is the famous Blue Train. There's tracks on here like Locomotion that for me were kind of life-changing in a way. I want to show you something. I plan on doing a 5 minutes on this at some point. That's Curtis Fuller on the trombone. And to play tempo on a trombone is not an easy thing to do. It takes some strong embouchure. And he's really killing it. Coltrane's already done his solo. And I heard this record probably 100 times. This is about 10 years ago now. And I was listening to this one day, and the band comes to a pause here, and Lee Morgan comes in, and what's that? And it was like an aha moment, a eureka, like, oh my God, he sounds so intense and so edgy. He sounds almost pissed off, like someone splashed him in the car by a puddle on the way into the studio that day. He's cursing into that trumpet. And it was kind of like that epiphany of like, oh, jazz musicians are telling us something beyond just virtuosity and playing. They're emoting their experience in a very immediate sense. I don't have to emote the content of the song lyric. I can emote whatever the fuck I'm feeling right now within that chord structure. The song might be a love story, but I ain't feeling love right now. I'm feeling fuck this motherfucker. And that's what jazz is. It's such an immediate remix of not just the tempo and not just the music, but of the emotional context of a piece of music. I can make it mine now and express an anger or a sorrow or a happiness, or and it's up to the listener to have the empathy and the comprehension to kind of grasp that. And I honestly think I had to go back and listen to all my jazz records over again at that point, because it just really changed a lot of the experience. Things that once thought were kind of Miles Davis playing love ballads became these kind of acerbic, bitter, fuck the worlds to me. So it was very insightful. Of course, he doesn't stay a Blue Note long, and his success with Miles convinces Atlantic to sign him. He does this kind of groundbreaking track, Giant Steps. I've broken the song down numerous times. It's mathematically incredibly complex, yet still accessible. But I love this record for more than just this track. I love it for Spiral. I love it for Countdown. I love it for Cousin Mary. But again, the tempo is fantastic. This is Countdown, and it's, for the most part, it's just Coltrane flying. It's just drums and sax, but it's intense. And then the song Spiral. I often say this is like my Slayer Seasons in the Abyss. It's 33 minutes of intensity. And it just always has something to say. And we're starting to see the seeking nature of Coltrane. How he's going to go out there and reinvent the world, you know, and the sky's the limit here. And he's seeing through the numbers, the math. He's starting to get the comprehension of, I can find new ways to express this music. Still on Atlantic. A song that's pretty infamous at this point, From the Sound of Music, is John Coltrane's My Favorite Things. I also love the version of Summertime on here. It's just, to me, it's glorious. It's a very accessible Coltrane. He's playing the soprano sax here. It's lyrical. It states the melody repeatedly, so you never get too far out in center field. yet he's still really chafing at the bit and kind of pushing the boundaries of this song structure. Like, if you listen to the original Sound of Music soundtrack and hear My Favorite Things, Kittens and String and all the shit that's going on in that, it's pretty fluffy. And he actually injects a lot of soul and a lot of passion and takes that melody that's really kind of sweet and saccharine and ends up making it kind of haunting. And again, that's jazz's ability to remix. Powerful stuff. Coltrane now, of course, moves on. He moves on to Creed Taylor's Impulse label. And I've stated in other videos before where I think Creed Taylor was hoping for the kind of success Coltrane had with My Favorite Things at Impulse. And I think he makes a trio of records that really kind of get close to what Creed Taylor was wanting. Accessible, commercially viable, beautiful, well-polished and produced. Of course, Ellington is the giant that is the root of the tree in so many ways, and probably almost twice Coltrane's age, maybe a third older, and Coltrane's still pretty young, and he's kind of an all-star at this point, but Coltrane, Ellington's a Hall of Famer, and so you feel the reverence from Coltrane, and you feel Ellington's respect for what Coltrane's doing. You know, I don't think Ellington ever didn't understand what someone was doing. I think Ellington was one of those cats that could hear you play for 5 minutes and see right into your soul. I think Ellington could see your motivations, what was driving your vehicle, clearer than you knew yourself. Because I don't think he could have written the songs for his musicians the way he did without that instinct. And so I think he's an incredibly insightful person, just in terms of personality and how he reads people, as much as he is brilliant as a composer and arranger, which he's the giant of American music. There's a couple tracks on this that to me are just absolutely heavenly. My Little Brown Book and In My Solitude are just... Is it Solitude? I forget the other one. Sentimental Mood, sorry. In a Sentimental Mood. Those two tracks especially, I think, should be on anyone's playlist for candlelight music that's just going to really enchant somebody. I myself love hearing Coltrane play ballads. I think the slower tempo gives him a little bit more time to think between the notes, and he still ends up being incredibly creative within the constraints of a ballad. This is, of course, the classic quartet with Alvin, Jimmy, McCoy, and John. They make a string of classic records here on Impulse at this point. Again, this is one of the records I think that Creed Taylor was pretty thrilled, although Bob Thiele's already producing this one. It's crazy how fast Creed Taylor comes and leaves, in a way. But it's just beautiful. And it should be anyone's collection. Jimmy Garrison, just that one note. Creating a gentle pulse. Great music should wash over you and have movement like that. The third in this set of records that Impulse makes that I find are just perfect is the records he does here with Johnny Hartman. And again, I've discussed this record probably before, but we're talking my favorite Coltrane records, and this is one of them. I love this record. It's the only record Coltrane does with a singer. And he knew of Hartman from some of his stuff earlier on, Regents, Savoy, Bethlehem, and of course he has a couple ABC and Paul ABC records, but he chose Hartman as his guy to do a vocal record with, and I think every song on this record is just glorious. The quartet is just perfect behind them. This is My One and Only Love, of course, and Coltrane does a wonderful job playing the melody. You know, he's not doing sheets of sound. He's not doing honking and exercising demons. He's playing, stating the melody, setting the table for Hartman to come in here. And he's actually playing more in the alto register there, because Hartman's going to come in the tenor baritone, and it creates a wonderful little contrast. In the world that doesn't hear this, feel this, and want to listen to this, I don't want to kick it with you. I'm just saying, like, it's great to have your own taste in music. It's great to have discretionary listening, be like, this is what I like. But we should also be open to what music we don't know and be willing just to go, okay, that is amazing, beautiful. If you don't hear the beauty in this, really, you kind of lose your validity as an opinion on music. You know, you're just dismissing something without even trying to comprehend it, trying to hear it. Everything that's happening here is just complete beauty. Here we see the Coltrane that I think most Coltrane fans really learned to love, really coming into shape. The quartet here on Crescent, it's the beginning and the dawning of spiritual jazz. And I've always felt Coltrane's music at this point was a prayer, an intercession to the gods, to the heavens, pleading, begging, trying to understand this mortal cage I'm stuck in and the struggle there within. He's not talking to one specific religious entity. He's speaking to the cosmos. And he makes that clear with a lot of his song titles and his album titles. This is not earthly music. This is heavenly music. And we're not talking the heaven of the Israelites or the heaven of the Christians or the heaven of the Muslims. We're talking the heavens above. Because honest seeking requires a certain amount of saying, I don't know. The first step in trying to understand is to set aside the predetermined answers that we've come to or been handed to us. So one has to want to question to understand truth. And one of the great things I grasped a few years back is truth is not something that can ever be told to us. Truth is something that we seek. You don't seek truth by seeking answers. You seek truth by finding the questions. Because once you have the questions, suddenly that world full of potential answers can be narrowed down because you have the right question to ask. So truth seeking is all in the question asking, not in the information gathering. Information is very relative and can change from perspective. The question validates the answers. And that's something I think once you kind of grasp it, it seems kind of like it's random, but it's not. If there's a chalkboard full of answers, 100 answers is on that chalkboard, and I say, tell me what the right answer is. Well, you would look at that board and be like, I can't tell you what the answer is. You know why? Because you don't have the question. So the question is a very important process, And I think Coltrane is asking those questions, not just musically, because he's definitely questioning the structure of the music, but he's also asking the questions in a spiritual sense, in a carnal fleshly sense, in a sexual sense. He's questioning all the foundations of the human experience and saying, okay, we're now living in a new global age. Perhaps it's time for us to recognize a new human condition, a new human shared experience and consciousness. The migration of us, it makes us one extended group. And unification is empowering. And it's the elite that need to keep us divided and do a pretty damn good job of that. One of the great Coltrane records of all time, The Love Supreme, and this is very much an extension of what's on Crescent. It's a prayer. It's a God, what the fuck? And I think if you hear it with that in your mind, it's empowering. Because he's speaking for us on our behalf. This is not a singular quest. This is not just saying, help me get it. Coltrane's good. He's like promising that I'm praying for all of us. And if I find the answer, if I get there, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to share it with you. One of the great gifts of humanity is a guy that dedicates his life to truth. A guy that dedicates his life to understanding. And the journey of Coltrane is one of a guru. He really climbs the mountain and attempts to disseminate the structures of the world that he was handed and born into. For me, one of the great pieces Coltrane ever does is on the Live at Birdland record. This is Alabama. And it's rooted firmly in the civil rights and just the sorrow and indignant anger that you feel watching a great injustice happen and being powerless to change it. And the South was on fire. The schools were being integrated. The National Guard was being called out. There was such a tension and a palpable fear and a concern that the second-class citizens were always going to be that. And the fear of the black man integrating into our societies with our wives and daughters is very real. And the impotent white male is so threatened by the virile potency of the black male stereotype that it fuels a hate and a fire and an anger. That is why those crosses burn. That is why those trees had strange fruit. And so when Coltrane does Alabama, he's hearing a nation torn. He's hearing a crossroads for not just his people, but for the planet itself. We need to see beyond the silly title of race. We need to see beyond the division of religion. We certainly shouldn't wear the label a nation. We need to find a broader identity that gives us the recognition of our shared agenda. Because that's just it. Black, white, yellow, American, Mexican, Spaniard, Muslim, Christian, Jew. We all kind of really want the same things. I want food in my kids' stomachs, my children at home safe at night, and hopefully the bills are paid. That's all any of us really want. People in Iran don't go to bed at night hating America. Their life's too busy. any more than you go to bed at night hating North Korea. And it takes a pretty powerful media presence to constantly inform and misinform us to get us to be so divided. And I think if Coltrane had seen the world today, the saxophone he put through his mouth at this point would probably catch fire. And I think he would be so disappointed in the path that we've chosen. And now I want to end with one of the more out things Coltrane does. I like Kula Se Mama a lot, but I think I've discussed that record a few times. So I chose Interstellar Space, which is just him and Rashid Ali on drums. And given the freedom of not having to have other musicians follow him, tonally, just the drummer. The drummer can set down a tempo, and now I can just express. And boy, I think civil rights and the economic difficulties and the drug addictions and just the state of the black community in America, Coltrane has so much he's talking about. And it's never, in the case of Coltrane, just a guy playing notes for the sake of notes. I feel like he's always linked to current events and the anxiety and the anger and the hope and the tenacity to fight, the optimism of hope. I think he's feeling like, I can battle enough demons with this saxophone that I can lighten everybody else's load. And I think if you listen to him with that in your brain, he can lighten your load. He can be an ambassador for you to the cosmos. That's pretty noble stuff. He intercedes on my behalf. See what I'm saying? Other guys have done that and had religions based on them. He was willing to die for me. If this killed him, he was going to do it. And he pretty much plays right up till near his death. And he got pretty weak in 66, 67. And we lost one of the true saints of not just this music, but of America and of the human experience. So Coltrane deserves all of our noble honor and praise. I don't think he'd want too much of the praise heaped on him or heaped on his playing. I don't think Coltrane wants to be remembered as some kind of virtuoso. I don't think he wants to think about people buying his record for $500. I think what he wants is for us to feel his heart and his soul and to be medicated by the painful battles he went through for us. That's as powerful as it gets. That's as important as music can be. So Coltrane's huge.